everybody, and welcome back to Fashion And with me, Scott Schiavone, Fashion Curator. We are kicking off season 2 of Fashion And by looking at a Parisian master couturier who, throughout the first few decades of the 20th century, challenged the established conventions of fashion, defined the avant-garde, and created one of the first lifestyle fashion brands. The theme of this episode is fashion and Poiret. Born in 1879, Paul Poiret grew up in the fashion capital of the world, Paris. Apprenticed to an umbrella maker, Poiret would save offcuts and scraps of material to take home, where he would construct dresses upon a small wooden mannequin. As a young man, Paul Poiret started to sketch dresses and followed the typical entry into the fashion world by shopping his designs around the various couture houses of Paris. Eventually, in 1898, 12 of his designs were purchased by the legendary Parisian couturier Madame Vionnet. This gave Poiret the exposure he needed, and he soon landed a job with his idol, Jacques Doucet, where he was encouraged and mentored by the man himself. After his national service, Poiret went to work for the House of Worth, but often clashed with Jean-Philippe, who considered his designs to be too out there for their more conservative clientele. He gave Paul Poiret the push he needed, and in 1903, he established his namesake couture house. This episode will explore Paul Poiret's contribution to the history of fashion through 5 themes: the King of Fashion, Poiret Signatures, Poiret and the Art of Pochoir, the 1002nd Night, and the Poiret Legacy. Paul Poiret dominated Parisian and international fashion during the first 2 decades of the 20th century. Known in America as the King of Fashion, but in Paris as simply Le Magnifique, Paul Poiret played an important role in redefining women's fashion. He is often credited with overturning Belle Epoch fashion values, freeing women of frivolous petticoats and corsets in favour of looser, cleaner lines. However, he was not single-handedly responsible for these radical changes. Other designers such as Madame Vionnet and Lucile, also known as Lady Duff Gordon, were also instrumental in implementing these changes. However, between 1903 and the start of World War I, Poiret experimented with various styles that accentuated the natural female form. He helped liberate women from the Edwardian S-shaped corset, and he shunned the subdued Edwardian colour palette of creams and pastels, and instead introduced rich and vibrant colours evocative of the exotic Orient. He pushed the envelope by blurring the lines between costume and fashion, using the stage and the theatre not only as inspiration, but often to debut and promote his latest creations. He offered a total lifestyle that was seductive, allowing women to realise their fantasies and incorporate them into their daily lives through their dress and style. Paul Poiret is often credited with pioneering such innovations as the hobble skirt, the harem pant, and the lampshade tunic. Not because he was the first designer to create these styles, but because he was a master of marketing and vigorous self-promotion. Paul Poiret's contribution to early 20th century fashion cannot be overestimated. Poiret introduced modernism into fashion and created a vocabulary of style that became synonymous with his name. The rose motif, designed by illustrator Paula Reeb between 1908 and 1909, was the symbol of the House of Poiret and was featured within the house logo, label, and stationery. The rose motif also appeared in numerous designs throughout his career, including his famous Josephine dress from 1907. Illustrated in La Robe de Paul Poiret, a surviving example of the dress forms part of the collection at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs in Paris. In the 1950s, the museum's curators and conservators decided to restore the rose, made from pink crepe and green satin, after it began to deteriorate, as they considered it such a significant motif and Poiret signature. Another dress that prominently features the Poiret rose was an ensemble worn by his wife and muse, Denise Poiret, dating to 1913. I'm actually a bit of a fan of roses myself. I mean, check out those tarts. Paul Poiret created a revolution in dressmaking, moving away from the established emphasis on pattern cutting and tailoring towards a skill set based on the principles of draping. Taking his cues from antique and regional styles of dress, Poiret reinterpreted the Japanese kimono, the Greek chiton, and the African and Middle Eastern kaftan. Poiret advocated fashions that were cut along straight lines, formed of rectangles, and made constructed from singular pieces of cloth. He used the female body and the art of draping to re-establish the rules of dressmaking. His method of draping was applied to daywear, evening gowns, and cocoon coats. In the summer of 1909, the Ballet Russe performed their first show in Paris, marking a turning point for fashion and the arts. Formed by Sergei Diaghilev, the bright colours of his sets and costumes, alongside those of Leon Bakst, made a huge impact throughout Europe, and exotic features such as turbans and harem pants were adapted for fashionable clothing. Paul Poiret was one such designer who embraced this orientalist aesthetic, although he did claim to have used these elements in his designs before 1909. Either way, orientalism became a defining signature of the House of Poiret, and the designer established a long tradition of appropriating motifs from Middle Eastern and Asian cultures. Poiret's use of orientalism was always associated with exoticism and a richer, freer, and more sensual way of life. As early as 1903, when Paul Poiret was working at the House of Worth, he had designed a controversial black kimono-style coat. Legend has it, when presented to the Russian Princess Baryatinsky, she described it as a horror, basically comparing the coat to the body bags used to cover up decapitated Russian peasants. How lovely! Despite this shocking reaction, this style permeated throughout Poiret's career, becoming one of his signatures and appearing in both his luxury Poshwar printed fashion catalogues. The harem pant was first shown by Paul Poiret in his spring 1911 collection. However, precursors of this design go as far back as 1870. Charles Frederick Worth's fancy dress costume, now part of the collection at the Met, shows Turkish trousers combined with an elaborately embroidered bodice. The harem pant was also featured in the costume designs of the Ballet Russe, 2 years before they appeared in the couture salons of Poiret. What we can give Poiret credit for was elevating the harem pant out of the realms of fancy dress and into the world of high fashion. Aimed at the ultra-modern and stylish fashionista, Poiret himself insisted that he designed harem pants for chic women to show off the harmony of her form and all the freedom of her native suppleness. Although versions of the lampshade tunic existed as early as 1911, it was not until 1913 that the silhouette appeared in Poiret's costume designs for Luminary, and was formally introduced in his couture collections. Known as the Sorbet, this evening ensemble was the most popular of its fashionable incarnations and was illustrated by Georges Lepape in the Gazette du Bon Temps in September 1913. There are three versions of the Sorbet that survive in museum collections today, one at the Museum at FIT, one at the V&A, and this example from the Chicago Historical Society. The bodice features a wrap-over kimono-style neckline and sash belt. The shape of the tunic is achieved through incorporating wire into the hem. The skirt underneath, known as the petto style, was a variation of Poiret's hobble skirt. Its wrap-over construction created the illusion of a narrow hem, but did not restrict walking. The Sorbet design became slightly contentious, as the illustrator Erte, who worked for Poiret from 1912, claimed ownership of the design, saying that it was one of the first ensembles he drew for Poiret. Controversial! In 1911, Poiret strengthened the link between fashion and lifestyle when he established two sister companies named after his daughters, Rosine and Martine. Maison Rosine, a perfume company, reflected and sent Poiret's Orientalist aesthetic by producing fragrances that used an abundance of exotic herbs and spices. Maison Martine, a decorative arts workshop, produced textiles and materials not only suitable for home furnishing, but also for dresses and coats. This meant that Poiret could promote a lifestyle whereby customers could immerse themselves in his world of exotic fashion, exuberant interiors, and intoxicating scents. Squish, squish, sweetie. Squish, squish. Paul Poiret believed that fashion, like art, should be constantly changing to reflect the zeitgeist. In the early 20th century, a printing technique known as pochoir was reinvigorated. Involving hand stenciling, multiple plates and layers were used, allowing for colours to be built up and gradually nuanced according to the artist's vision. This technique lent itself most suitably to the world of fashion illustration, and in October 1908, La Robe de Paul Poiret was published in a limited run of only 250 copies. The book, made in homage to all the great ladies of the whole world, contained 10 full-page illustrations of Poiret gowns and was illustrated by Paul Arribe, a satirical graphic artist whose illustrative style suited Poiret's modern designs. The dresses, predominantly neoclassical in style, with empire waistlines, epitomised modernity with their bright colours and rejection of ornamentation. Poiret's designs questioned the frivolous aesthetics of the Belle Epoch and the styles of his rival designers. The art of pochoir captured the vibrancy and colour palette of Poiret's aesthetic and set a new precedent for the depiction of fashion. In 1911, Poiret teamed up with Georges Lepape, who had studied at the École des Beaux-Arts, to publish the bigger and more ambitious Les Choses de Paul Poiret. This publication was printed in a run of 1,000 copies, 300 were gifted to friends and clients, and 700 were available for the general public to purchase at a cost of 50 francs each. Okay, just to add some perspective here, in 1911, 50 francs was just over a year's wages for a skilled tradesman, so at that price, only the very wealthy could afford that. In Les Choses de Paul Poiret, Lepape took a more sensual approach to Poiret's designs, reiterating the Oriental style and influence of his creations. Almost every model is dressed in a turban, some hold parrots, whilst others lounge in the exotic interiors of Poiret's couture house. This was fashion presented in the realms of fine art, and was influential in establishing Georges Lepape's career as one of the greatest fashion illustrators of the early 20th century. Paul Poiret was famous for staging lavish parties, his most famous being the Persian-themed The Thousand and Second Night. Like Diaghilev's Scheherazade, Poiret's The Thousand and Second Night revolved around a fantastic evocation of the East. The event took place on the evening of the 24th of June 1911 and stipulated on the invitation that all 300 guests were to dress in Oriental costumes. According to his autobiography, Poiret knew that some of his guests would not adhere to the strict dress code. This deliberately gave Paul Poiret an opportunity, as those who did not meet the requirements were sent home unless they were willing to be dressed in a costume that Poiret himself had designed. He admitted, "I knew the carelessness of some of my friends and I had taken measures to counteract it." Sneaky, sneaky Paul Poiret. Or just a marketing genius. Believed to have been worn on that infamous night, this exquisite ensemble epitomises Poiret's Orientalist style and clearly shows the influence of Diaghilev's Ballet Russe and the costume designs by Leon Bakst. The construction resembles that of the sorbet gown. The bejewelled tunic with wired hem is worn over harem pants and gathered in at the ankles. Poiret himself wore a fur-trimmed kaftan and jewelled turban, greeting his guests from a green and gold throne. The party decor featured brightly lit trees with live parrots, pink ibis, monkeys, Persian rugs, multicoloured cushions, and music was played by orchestras from Egypt, India, and Turkey. Alchemists prepared an exotic array of cocktails, and Poiret's wife, Denise, lounged like a queen in a locked golden cage. When all 300 guests were in attendance, Poiret rose and, followed by all my women, went towards the cage of my favourite to whom I restored her freedom. The whole evening was scented with Poiret's new creation, Nuit Persane, meaning Persian night, a bottle of which was gifted to each guest. Nicknamed the Prophet of Simplicity by Vogue in 1913, ironically it was the simplicity of post-World War I modernism that ultimately destroyed Poiret. He continued to produce original and extravagant designs, however, he failed to recognise or understand the profound effect the war had had on the lives and lifestyles of women. He found it hard to embrace the androgynous garçon look of the 1920s, pioneered by Chanel with her simple but meticulously cut clothing executed in a monochromatic palette. Throughout the 1920s, the house suffered, failing to adapt to the new modern woman, and eventually, by the close of the decade, the company collapsed. Paul Poiret died in 1944, bankrupt and forgotten by the designers whose trail he had blazed. Despite falling out of fashion, Paul Poiret's style and aesthetic has remained influential, and references to his work were seen in John Galliano's early collections at Dior and in editorials for Vogue magazine. In 2018, after a 90-year hiatus, the brand was revived and presented its first collection for autumn-winter 2018 under the creative direction of Yiqing Yin. Yin's interpretation captured the essence of Paul Poiret without regurgitating historical references. She interpreted Poiret's ethos for a modern world. Despite a positive reception and appearances on the red carpet, the house announced that after just two seasons, they were parting ways with Yiqing Yin. As yet, a successor has still to be announced. Although today, Paul Poiret's style is considered as cultural appropriation, his designs were symptomatic of an era now firmly in the past. If these clothes were produced today, there would certainly be a backlash against his use of Japanese, Middle Eastern, and Asian design elements. What is clear is that his avant-garde designs, extravagant lifestyle, and shameless self-promotion were successful in ensuring that his name was stamped into the history books as the great protagonist of modernism in early 20th century fashion. He may not have single-handedly freed women of corsets and petticoats, he may not have exclusively invented the harem pant or lampshade tunic, but he did ensure that his name was forever associated with changing the course of women's fashion forever. Well, that's it for today, folks, and episode 1 of season 2 of Fashion And. I hope you enjoyed looking at Le Magnifique Paul Poiret, the King of Fashion. Season 1 of Fashion And is available to watch. Just click on the playlist section and you can access it there. And for those of you who don't have time to watch a full-length episode, there is a series of Fashion And minisodes, each between about 2 and 4 minutes long, that you can watch too. Just head over to the playlist section and you'll find it there. Please comment, like and share, and please don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss a thing from Fashion And with me, Scott Schiavone, Fashion Curator.